Yeah, Anuj, I think the first wave and second wave, there are fundamental difference. One, in first wave when it was going through, we never expected second wave. And for a change, the fear was intense. Whereas in the second wave, the expectation is that there will be a third wave. So the fear from second to third might get prolonged, and that might redefine the in consumer behavior. So to that extent, this prolonging of the fear that third wave is going to come at some point of time, that would, I think, redefine the consumer behavior. Even policymakers, they would also be very cautious. But because of that, quite possible that the interest rates, liquidity, and even the fiscal incentive by the government, that could become far bigger thing. So I think it's a much more complex after 1.5 years of COVID. The situation has completely changed. I mean, quite a bit of change is there. And at the same time, recovery is recovery. Again, you see a recovery trade starting from next month or month after that. I mean, basically the demand destruction because of COVID has been two types. One, where the demand can never come back. What you didn't consume. And those companies like liquor company or say even aviation company, all these companies, they will come back to pre-COVID levels of performance. But there are some businesses, like say automobile and all, where the demand is postponed. And what happens is that, say, disruption is for, say, 4 months or 5 months, and now for almost a year or so. So when the economy comes back, those demand, every single piece of motorcycle or car or truck, whatever needs to be bought, trucks, everything will be brought, everything will be bought. Hence, it's a postponement of demand rather than destruction of demand. But then the markets are punishing both the companies almost. Like if the quarterly result is bad, markets are punishing both the companies almost in the same style. And hence, I think some of the opportunities will come in the this so-called durable kind of companies where demand is not destroyed, but only postponed. Say IT has been the mother of all the value migration from Boston to Bangalore, and in last 20 years, the country has almost built a $170 billion of export machine. Very awesome machine they have built, and it is expected that next 2 3 years will be even faster growth than what we have seen in last few years. So we are staring at maybe $200 billion of export in maybe next 2 to 3 years' time. So that's the big one, and there is acceleration. And in that situation, of course, biggies will do well in terms of 10, 11, 12, 13%. But the mid-sized companies, smaller companies, they have an opportunity to grow faster because economics remains pretty strong. And on top of it, what is happening is that work from anywhere, where the work is coming to the doorstep of the worker, I think the visa issues, which were always a problem in how many people can enter US, and hence what with the mix of on-site and off-site and all, and the constraint on the execution, I think that will broadly go away, and hence very accelerated execution can happen, and we might see even bigger migration than ever before. So that looks to be one spot where things are going to happen. Second, I think insurance industries, they all the time they sell fear, and the fear has been the maximum today for the lives after the COVID or during the COVID. So I think having done a little less business last year, my sense is next 2 3 years, insurance industries, general as well as life insurance, particularly health insurance, life insurance, they should see huge pickup in their businesses. And penetration in any case is low. And then within that, between the private sector and public sector, you can see the migration happening from market share going from public sector to private sector. And a 15% growth industry, may mean for the listed private sector companies, more like 20-25% kind of a growth. And it's a very high quality business, so, and a very stable business. So those kind of things are visible right now, which may happen under value migration. No, I mean, clearly those businesses will come back to the pre-pandemic level, and some of them might actually gain, because the recovery this time is going to be far more defined, and I'm quite sure that this time it will be far sharper K-shaped recovery rather than much more broad-based recovery. Because what happened was that in the first round, some of the companies got weakened and that market share went to the stronger one. But now in the second round, some of the companies which could, you know, muster some amount of more money, they'll get further weakened in this round of a prolonged second wave and fear of third wave. So I'm quite sure that recovery going forward will be K-shaped, and the bigger, stable and hungry companies, they will do much better compared to the smaller, mid-sized, badly financed, badly run. Those companies will suffer in the hands of efficiently run companies. It looks like, see, another factor is the superabundance of liquidity. The whole world is completely deluged in terms of amount of liquidity which central banks have pumped. And in a small way, in our own country also, we have unprecedented liquidity. But worldwide, the cost of liquidity and size of liquidity available to the market or speculators is unprecedented. So what they will do, of course, they will chase the successful companies wherever growth emerges. I think the value of growth is disproportionately high at this point of time. So any growth company, and particularly newly discovered growth companies, they'll go 5-6x in just 12 months time. So that's the kind of nature of the market I see right now. I mean, I would buy what I understand, first thing. So I don't classify that much in terms of categories, but automotive segment, entire automotive segment looks very interesting for opening up. And some of the other industrial stocks could also do well, but I'm not very good in understanding the capital goods side of it. But clearly, automotive companies, entire spectrum of two-wheeler, three-wheeler, four-wheeler, even trucks, tractors, all of them, they will be beneficiary not only of the postponed demand, but also they will be beneficiary of low interest rates and a very stimulated economy post-COVID. So, and massive purchasing power unleashed by high commodity prices, very good crops, and ample liquidity. So I would think that this entire place, and these companies are very good. I mean, there is not surprise in terms of competitive forces. The margins are good, cash flow is good, and valuations are very expensive. So I would think that that's a segment where one should, my portfolio is fully allocated, but whatever we trim here and there, we would like to put in there some chips out there. One of the problem of valuation is also the depressed economic activity. So in some, say, like market cap to GDP itself, which is looking at more like more than one time, that is impacted by low level of GDP. Say for 2 years, now GDP is not recovered. It is standing at still at literally 200 trillion rupees. So in normal case, it could have been more like 235, 240 trillion. Thanks to COVID, we are at just about 200. So same is the case with the companies. A lot of companies, true earnings power, say retail company, if it is opening up shops continuously, and but then turnover is down because of the lockdowns, I think whenever they open up, say 22, 23 in full year, they will get full turnover on the expanded capacity. So that's why the markets are slightly running ahead of those expectations. And hence the valuations might look little more elevated today looking at their depressed earnings. But we have to be a little more understanding on each and every company's situations, how the valuation is going. Yeah, so you are at about 50,000 now, and in 10 years' time, we are saying you may. I mean, see, nothing in the future is guaranteed or happens for sure. You may, because if you compound it 15%, in 5 years you will double, and in another 5 years you will again double. So it will be 4x. So your 50,000 will go to more like 200,000 by the time you end next 10 years. And another thing is that in last 10 years, the return has been suboptimal, like more like 9-10%. When you are long-term run rate is more like 30-40%. So there is some amount of firepower if economy is unleashed post-COVID, hopefully, in next 10 years. There is a good chance that, and if by chance instead of 200,000, we go to 170,000 or we go to 230,000. I think the more important thing is that the sustained, the law of compounding, which has worked for last 40 years, will work for next 10 years also. I don't see any reason why it will not work, whether it goes to 180 or whether it goes to 220. I think we have to give a number and possibility of that number, basically. So I don't see that as a huge stretch target or anything like that. Whether they have converted into opportunity or not, that little later it will come into focus. I mean, how they converted and how they changed the business model or those things like that. But you know, you keep hearing a lot of corporate story, how they are tackling the crisis and how they have helped people like, say, like L&T, had a very large number of workers who were they were trying to migrate back to the hometowns, and they created a camps for thousands and thousands, almost 100,000 people. They kept in camp and took care of them in the lockdown and all. So those things will go a long way in terms of how the workers behave post-COVID. So right now, still we are in COVID, but I'm quite sure these kind of companies will be rewarded for their fantastic effort during COVID period. I mean, I think the post-COVID stories are going to be a little later, you know, as the COVID shadow is over and when we see the results of the companies. But I have seen a lot of, some companies which are completely offline, store-based kind of sales, suddenly we are finding 20-30% of the sales has become online. And that has become their pure surviving kind of a way. And they have been able to take care of some of the employees which would have been otherwise been offloaded. So we will get to see many more stories, maybe after 6 months of our lockdown is completely over. Right now it is too early to call. To say that this company has really been able to turn around the situation and has really taken advantage of this particular crisis. I think both types of opportunities are there, but the domestic, company by company, the domestic opportunity is clearly, the truck cycle. I believe the truck sales have plunged to, I think, 2 decades low. And it is literally half of or one third of what is a peak level. And now we are talking about infra boom, which is going to be historically highest. So in next 2-3 years, when that level of infra boom picks up, once normalization comes, in that case, you are going to need a lot many more trucks than whatever we ever bought. So I think, and it's a very concentrated kind of a situation, whether it is Ashok Leyland, whether it is a telco, or whether it is a Eicher, VCVV. So there are only 2-3 players who are going to play into that. So like that, even in the two-wheeler industry, you have just about three players only. And what is going to, I think one of the thing is also about the cost escalation which has happened in last 2-3 years because of regulatory changes from BS4 to BS6 and other regulations. And that has hurt the demand big time. And on top of it, now COVID has happened. So purchasing power of a lot of people is also smashed. So how things come up? What will be the fiscal response of the government to build the demand back? My sense is that one way or other, I think government has to come and help the consumers build the demand. And if the demand comes back, I mean, if there is no relief from the government, demand will come back slowly. But if there can be a fiscal relief for some time, limited period, I think they can build the demand very, very quickly. So I think, and the valuations are very reasonable. So I would, across the board, I think in the sector, it depends on who likes what. There are multiple titles in many companies, like in Bajaj Auto, you have export, you have three-wheelers, you have a whole lot of other things. So, I mean, one has to see the companies in their own merits. I mean, everything looks to be, entire basket looks to be very attractive to me. No, COVID is the biggest risk. I mean, the third wave coming in. Again, because first round you get hurt by 20%, another round you get another 20-30% hurt. But I mean, there's a limit to which the economy can sustain. So that remains the biggest risk. And then second is the inflation. You know, I mean, can the inflation spike beyond the tolerance of the authorities? And then their hands will be tied on the fiscal as well as monetary side. So I mean, beyond that, I think. If COVID subsides, I think everything will be taken care of, and government seems to be very much focused on bringing the growth back by all means. So I'm pretty happy to be in the market fully committed, except my fear is the COVID.